Does it even make sense to do DDR4 RAM or Gen 3 NVMe drives anymore? Well, my sponsors for this video, Newegg and Crucial, don't seem to think so. And believe it or not, at this point, I'm actually inclined to agree with them. Oh man, what a ride it has been for both Gen 4 NVMe drives and more recently DDR5 RAM. It has been a bit of a bumpy launch for both of them, with both CPU companies, meaning Intel and AMD, using them as perks to help push people to upgrade or give people options like DDR4 and DDR5 in the case of Intel. But before we jump too far ahead, let's take a look at what's changed for these two technologies and why the question is now so important. Now let's start with the good old Gen 4 NVMe drive. So starting things off with PCIE Gen 3, you have a transfer rate of about 8 gigatransfers per second, while PCIE Gen 4 doubled that with 16 gigatransfers per second. What that means is that a Gen 3 NVMe drive topped out at about 3,500 megabits per second, while a Gen 4 NVMe SSD can hit well north of 7,000 megabits per second. Now over the course of when Gen 4 launched, back in 2017, companies have been working on getting both of the cost of the technology down, as well as the heat generation, which today is in a much better spot. Here you can look at two different Crucial NVMe SSDs, the P3 and the P3 Plus. The P3 is a 1 terabyte Gen 3 NVMe SSD hitting up to 3,500 megabits per second and costing around $50, while the P3 Plus is a 1 terabyte Gen 4 NVMe SSD hitting 5,000 megabits per second and only costing a little less than $25 more. Or you can jump up to the 6,600 megabits with the Crucial P5 Plus for only $30 more. The short of it is, the more expensive that Gen 4 NVMe's have a tendency to get, it usually has to do with endurance and speed. So usually you're actually paying more money for the endurance technology and not necessarily the speed technology. So that's the short of it as you go from like the P3 to P3 Plus, which is Gen 4, and then up to the P5. So now let's look at RAM, specifically the difference between DDR4 and DDR5. So first off, DDR5 is actually a big upgrade from DDR4, just like DDR4 was a big upgrade from DDR3. Now you might be saying, Robey, why are you saying this? Well, here's the deal. Not all upgrades are actually that significant, but in the case of actual RAM, it actually is a pretty big jump. Now, when the biggest difference is between DDR4 is that DDR4 had a single 64-bit bus, when DDR5 actually has two separate 32-bit channels. What this means is that when you have two DDR4 DIMMs, you have four 32-bit channels versus just two 64-bit channels, which can all be accessed simultaneously, hence doubling the amount of bandwidth. The other difference is the power management and controllers are now on the DIMMs themselves versus on DDR4, where it was all managed by the motherboard. This means that manufacturers can work to improve compatibility independently of motherboard manufacturers, and these modules will also be more power efficient. Now, the last thing that is worth talking about is actually the starting speeds of DDR5 versus DDR4. DDR5 essentially takes off where DDR4 left off. With starting at 4,800 megatransfers per second, we were barely hitting over 4,000 on DDR4. So we can also have higher capacities on our DIMMs, where we're used to 8, 16, and 32, and potentially 64 on DDR4. Now you can have 16, 32, 24, 48, and even higher on DDR5 because of the new ways that this is architected and the pinout design. Now, initially at launch, DDR5 was like stupidly expensive, and the improvements to performance were negligible in a lot of ways, and that stigma's kind of stuck. Even to the point that Intel released both their Gen 12 and Gen 13 CPUs and provided the option of both DDR4 and DDR5 and marketed it as a limitation of AMD, given 7000 series CPU only provided DDR5 options. That's meaning to say you could go buy a Gen 12 or Gen 13 PC for substantially less money because you weren't stuck buying DDR5, but things have changed because now DDR5 is far less expensive. Well, let's take a look, shall we? So here we are on Newegg, and here we're looking at a 32 gigabyte pack of Crucial DDR4 at 3,200 megatransfers per second for $76.99. Now we can also check here also at Newegg for 32 gigs of DDR5 at 4,800 megatransfers for $129.99. That's only a $50 difference. Now that is a significant drop from when it launched, when we were paying $340 for 5,200 megatransfer RAM, which you can see here is a 5,600 megatransfer RAM from Crucial for $152.99. So yeah, it's a whole lot cheaper. Okay, Robey, so you've covered the history and what's better, but in the end, what does that mean for me as a gamer? Well, let's talk about Gen 4 NVMe SSDs first. When we look at the Crucial P3 Plus and we put it up against a Gen 3 drive like the Lexar NM620, let's take a look at like some PC Mark bench comparisons. When you look at the system's drives and the storage benchmark, you can see a significant jump from Gen 3 to Gen 4 in terms of score, with an almost 750-point jump in the full system score. But the most important numbers and the easiest to understand are these ones that are right here when you compare the load and game-related scores between the two. In all cases, for bandwidth, you can see the load bandwidth and access times have all improved for Battlefield, Black Ops, and Overwatch. The other big jump is in the move game bandwidth, which has jumped by over 1,000 megabits per second. That means that your games will load faster, and as you copy stuff around, it will be quicker, up to a second faster in many cases. Now, sure, saving time is great, and I'll be honest, it's not gonna be crazy noticeable, but over time, it does actually add up. But the real magic for Gen 4 drives like this is not necessarily about load times or copy times. It's actually about a new thing called direct storage from Microsoft. Essentially, when you play games on your PC, every time the game needs data, the data is loaded from the CPU to your memory and then back to the CPU, then back to the GPU. It's a convoluted and slow, relatively speaking, when we talk about PC slow. Microsoft's direct storage and even a new technology from Nvidia called RTX IO allows graphics cards to load directly from your storage, meaning you're skipping the CPU and your RAM altogether. And that means the faster your storage, the faster your graphics card can load information. It's why consoles like the PlayStation 5 and the Xbox Series S and X can still do so much graphically because both of these consoles have a type of system that allows transfers of data to be much more efficient and quick. Now that technology is moving to PC now with direct storage and RTX IO, and in the very near future, you will have games that take advantage of this technology. And that's where 5,500 megabits per second or 6,600 megabits per second is going to make a big difference in why the PlayStation 5 requires such a fast NVMe drive for its added storage solution. Yes, the Xbox also has an added storage solution, but it's proprietary to Seagate, and you can bet your bottom dollar it is also fast as heck. So very soon, Gen 4 NVMe drives aren't just going to be about saving you load times and copies, but they're actually going to make a much better gaming experience with other things like quick resume, etc. But the question is, then Robey, what about DDR5? Well, I'm glad you asked. I felt the safest thing here is to compare games between what you used for your average inexpensive DDR4 against your average inexpensive DDR5. So in this case, we took a Core i7-13700K and put it in an ASUS TUF Gaming Z690 Plus DDR4 motherboard and then used the exact same motherboard, but the DDR5 variant. We paired this with an EVGA RTX 3070 Ti and we used 3200 megatransfer DDR4 RAM and put it up against entry-level DDR5 at 4800 megatransfer. And as you can see here, with many of the games, when we're doing a baseline, we always see some jump, anywhere from almost negligible, but there is a jump, up to as much as 9 frames per second when we look at 1440p numbers as a direct comparison. And as the speeds go up in DDR5, you can even see that gap start to widen. It's a very similar story to what I was telling you about with direct storage. And this is very true on the AMD Ryzen side, specifically when you start getting to 6,000 megatransfer in terms of it's like ideal for Infinity Fabric. But that's a whole nother video for a whole nother time. Essentially, as more modern games get better, the more bandwidth and getting access to data is going to get much faster. Okay, so let's wrap this up. Here's the deal. Let's make this short and sweet. If you're building a new PC, or you're gonna purchase a new PC with newer games, especially as their engines begin to advance, the world in which these DDR5 and Gen 4 become optional is passing, especially now that the overall cost of those devices has come way down. I'm gonna show you Newegg again. And here you're looking at a DDR4 and DDR5 variant of the same exact Z790 board from ASUS, the ASUS TUF. And you can see that the price is almost entirely the same. With direct storage and more gaming architecture changes, essentially, the small tax for jumping into Gen 4 or DDR5 is, what, 100, 150 bucks? And that is so well worth it when you think about embracing the new technology that is on the verge of being a part of our gaming experience here in PC. That's direct storage or other optimizations that will make your gaming and PC using experience that much faster and better with new game releases and even some older games like Shadow the Tomb Raider, which is a great example where we saw one of the biggest jumps in overall performance. So again, huge shout out to Newegg and Crucial for sponsoring today's video and allowing me the opportunity to walk through this with you because this is such an important subject. And by the way, if you're looking for good baseline DDR5 RAM modules, check out the links down in the description below, as well as for the P5 and P3 Plus options of Gen 4 NVMe drives. But now it's not about what I think, it's about what you think. And I'm guessing that you were actually probably surprised by some information. For instance, probably at the price. Were you surprised at the cost difference between Gen 3 and Gen 4 and even DDR4 and DDR5? Because I bet you it's a lot smaller than you thought it was. And lastly, did you even know about these new technologies like direct storage and RTX IO and how these are going to help improve your overall gaming experience and where the speeds from these new technologies are going to make such a big difference for you and your gaming experience? And lastly, did something in this video actually change your mind? I'd love to know all that and more down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so you get a notification each and every time we post a new video right here on Robeytech. And if you want to see us use these awesome devices, then you should check out our live channel over at youtube.com/RobeytechLive, where we're always using DDR5, DDR4, Gen 3, Gen 4. We try to show you all the stuff, benchmark it, all that stuff live every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, starting at 5 p.m. Pacific time. Lastly, if you have questions about this stuff or you want to continue the conversation, head over to our Discord server, discord.gg/RobeyTech. It's a great place to find other tech and PC enthusiasts that love to talk about these very subjects. And you know what? You might make a friend. Lastly, make sure you follow us at Robeytech absolutely everywhere. Guys, we really hope you enjoyed this video. Again, huge shout out to Newegg and Crucial for sponsoring, and we look forward to seeing you on the next one.